Hi,
Hello. Great evening, everyone. Welcome to the seventh episode of Beautiful Mind, a live chat show with aunts and uncles around the world with me, Kirti. Learning a different language is not only learning different words for the same thing, but another way of thinking in a different way. Today, I have with me Dr. Maitri Menon, who believes that things in her life has happened unexpectedly, and those unexpected moments have changed her life. She's a linguist. She's a professor at Wichita University, US, a music aficionado, and a food enthusiast. Hello, Maitri. Thank you so much for joining me here, and welcome to my show.
Thank you so much for having me, Kirti. It's a pleasure.
All right. I could see my viewers are joining there. So how are things there? All good?
All good.
Safe at home?
Yes. We have been in quarantine, so yeah, things are good.
All right, that's great. Okay. All right, Maitri, let's start off the show here as it's sharp 7:30. Just out of curiosity about one thing in my, in my mind when I was speaking to you a couple of days back, that a lady who was doing her science stream all of a sudden into the English line or the linguist part. How did this happen?
Yeah. So I was interested in computer science and math and physics and chemistry when I was in 11th standard and 12th standard. But I knew at the point that I did not want to become an engineer or, you know, go the professional route that everybody else in my class was actually following. So I decided that, okay, I want to do a BSc in chemistry, right? I was really interested in organic chemistry, something that I think a lot of people are like, no, I don't like chemistry, like organic chemistry and the lab sections and all that. But I was really interested in that. And I thought, okay, I'll do a BSc chemistry and I want to do a PhD in chemistry later on. So I looked at the requirements for the BSc chemistry and I said, okay, well, there is a lot of math in here that I wasn't very keen on. So I said, okay, that doesn't really look like what I want to do because, you know, I don't want to be like, this is, you know, 1 year down the line, take the program and then decide that I don't want to do this and then change the track, right? So I decided, okay, what's the next thing that I really like? So I really like to write. I like to talk. I like communication. And I've always been interested in languages. So I thought maybe the communication, mass communication, journalism stream is really good. So I decided to do communicative English, which was really new at that time in centuries as it was one of, I think, you know, maybe only 3 or 4 years since it had started. So it was still very brand new. I really liked the syllabus. I really liked the teachers. So it was really interesting to actually see what it held for me in the future. So that's really how I decided that I will go from BSc chemistry to mass communication and journalism. It was, again, it was an unexpected move, right? But it's one that, looking back, I'm really happy about.
That's great. So did you have the normal routine of family and relatives behind you saying that you're a very studious girl? Why do you want to go for this? Because we generally have a tradition of a science student straight away joining either a medicine or an engineering. So did you also have the same problem?
No. So my mother has always been encouraging in whatever I do. And she is really the reason why I am where I am, because she never pushed me to be, you know, go in one direction. She always said, follow your heart, right? Like, do what you like, do what you're best at, right? So she never put that pressure on me. My father didn't care. He still doesn't care. So he's like, okay, you know, she will do whatever she wants to do and she'll be happy doing that, right? It's her decision. So I never had pressure from my family in deciding to go in one stream or the other. My father is an engineer. My mother is a master's in literature. So, you know, we are house divided in humanities and science that way. And I think my father was very happy that I decided to follow my mother's route and not his route. So, because my father used to teach me maths when I was a kid and it did not go well. So I think he has really, you know, memories associated with that saying, it's better that she goes after her mother and not her father.
So that your mother can take care of yourself.
Yes. Yeah. And it's my mother's headache, right? Not my father's. So.
All right. Okay. So after your graduation, you did your master's in mass communication, is it? Can you just tell me something about that as well?
Yeah. So So I finished my BA, and then I was kind of like at crossroads, right? Because again, I thought maybe I'll do a master's in mass communication and journalism because that really seemed like the logical next step. But I wanted to go outside of Cochin, right? So I wanted to actually apply to an MFA program, a master's in fine arts program in University of Illinois, Wisconsin-Madison, right? I don't know if you remember Aisha, ma'am, Aisha Ravindran, who was, maybe she had already left by the time that you had come into the program, but
maybe
she
that's
was one of my mentors in the undergraduate program in St. Teresa's. And so she was the one who told me that Maithili applied to this program because I used to write a lot of poetry and, you know, I used to participate in all these intercultural competitions and all that. So she told me apply for this MFA program. It's in University of Illinois, Madison. It's a really nice program. So I told my mother and father. My mother said, no, you're only, you know, you're 18 years old. You're not going to go to America at this point. So I said, okay, well, I mean, if I'm not going to do an MFA, I might as well pursue a master's in mass communication and journalism. So I really was interested in Central Institute of Englishes and Foreign Languages in Hyderabad. The university has then become autonomous. So right now it's called as the English and Foreign Languages University. It was called CEPL when I was studying. But right now it's called EFLU. So English and Foreign Languages University, because it's an autonomous university. So I was interested in CEPL because Anita Devasya, ma'am, who was also one of my mentors, during my undergrad, did her MPhil and MLit there. So she was the one who kind of, you know, told me, Maithili, that's a really good option for you. Why don't you try and write that entrance exam and all that? So I did that. I got in. The way CEPL works is that 60 students are admitted into the master's program, but we don't decide what track we want to choose, right? So we get admitted, and then as the 2 years go by, you decide what you want to do. So there was mass communication and journalism. There was literature. There was cultural studies. There was linguistics. There were all these kind of really exotic, you know, kind of degrees that you could choose from depending on what you really wanted to do. So I started out by thinking that I wanted to do a master's in cultural studies. Cultural studies was something that was really appealing at that point because of Anita Devasya, ma'am, because her MLit was in cultural studies. And so I was really influenced by her ideas and her thought process at that point. But I had an idea of what cultural studies was, which was very different from what actually cultural studies was. So I started doing that for a semester, and I decided by the end of the semester that this is really not for me, right? Because what my ideology was very different from the program itself and the kind of ideology that that program kind of adhered to. So I decided, okay, well, now what do I do? So I took a couple of classes in mass communication, a couple of classes in literature, and then I decided, why not linguistics, right? So in my second semester of my master's, I decided that, okay, I'm going to sit in this class, right? So I sat in this linguistics class by Professor Amrita Valli. It was a syntax class, and I had no idea what was going into it. And I decided then that this is my career. This is what I want to do. This is my calling. And there's been no turning back, right? So then I finished my master's in linguistics. I did my MPhil in linguistics. I started my PhD program, and then I finished it in America. So it's been
a... I know. I'm sorry. I would like to interrupt you because I started saying that he believes in unexpected things to happen in our life. So I remember you said something unexpected happened when you went for a camp, and that is how you you turned up from your PhD, and then there you are in US. So can you just share that experience along with us? And that's unexpected.
So I was very happy in CEPL Hyderabad, right? I mean, I was there for 6 years. CEPL is, at that point, it was a very small, you know, close-knit kind of community. Everybody knew everybody. We had a great hostel. You know, I can see some of my friends from the hostel has joined. So, you know, we had a lot of fun. we had a lot of freedom. Hyderabad is a great place, you know. So it was a very... fun and close-knit kind of community. And I never wanted to leave. I mean, once my mother said at 18 that you're not going to Illinois, Maithili, for the MFA program, there was no US in my radar, right? Like I was happy in Hyderabad. I was a senior research fellow, which is given by the government of India. So I had my my program was funded. I didn't have to worry about anything. And I was very happy there, except for maybe the hostel food, but you know, we will not talk about that. So, so I attended a linguistics camp in the Himalayas. This was in 2009. So it was after I had started my PhD. So I started my PhD mm-hmm. in 2008. So this was 2009, 1 year into the PhD program. This was a linguistic summer camp. It happens every summer. And it happens mm-hmm. somewhere in the Himalayas. So the year that I went, mm-hmm. it happened in Kausani. And so I went for the camp, and then there were professors there from London, there were professors there from US, and they would teach classes. And it was really an opportunity to kind of see the research that was happening outside of US. It was really an opportunity for me to understand how linguistics is so different, like, you know, in different countries, right? And so it was really interesting to attend this class by Professor Hagith Borre, who was then a professor in US, and now she's actually in London. She moved to London a couple of years ago. So Hagith was the one who actually said, Maithili, why don't you apply to this PhD program in her university in the US? And I said, no. You know, like I'm already 2 years into this program. It's a funded program. I'm in my mid 20s. I don't want to uproot myself and, you know, like move to a different country. I was never really interested in going to the US at that point because I was so close to finishing my PhD because I'd already finished 2 years of it. So I said, okay, you know, I'll think about it. And then we came back to Hyderabad. And then Hagith and other professors in the university emailed my professors in Hyderabad saying that Maithili should mm-hmm. apply to, you know, this program. And so they started putting pressure on me. And I said, okay, fine, I'll apply, but only to this university, just because they were putting pressure on me, right? So this was the University of Southern California in Los Angeles. And I said, okay, if I get in, I get in. If I don't, I don't, right? I already have a PhD program that I'm a part of, so it doesn't really matter. So I applied and I got in. And I was like, okay, well, now what do I do, right? So my professor was like, okay, you've got it now. You have to decide, right? Like whether you want to move or not. So I decided that I'll go for open house because at that point, US had a lot of money. They would send money to go for the open houses. So I said, okay, it's a free paid trip to Los Angeles. Who wouldn't go, right? So let's go. So I treated it like, you know, it was a trip. I love traveling. I've always been a traveler all my life. So I decided that, okay, well, I'll just go. I had friends in Los Angeles. So I said, okay, I'll see them. You know, I'll get to see Los Angeles. Why not? I went there and I loved Los Angeles and I loved the university. And I said, okay, this is an opportunity that I shouldn't let go because it was so unexpected, right? It was one of those things that it wasn't like I actively pursued it and I said, this is what I want, this is where I want to go, but it came to me. And at that point, I decided that, you know, I can either decide to stay in my comfort zone where everything was familiar and everything was, you know, that made me happy was around me, or I could decide to challenge myself and uproot myself and go to this country where everything is new, right? And start like life all over again. This time my mother couldn't say no because I was, you know, mid 20s. So she couldn't say no because I was older. But I think this was also something that my parents never kind of imagined would happen, right? It was something that just, it's destiny, right? I mean, that's really what I want to say, that it was an opportunity that knocked on my door and I opened it, right? And let the opportunity in. So I'm very happy about that.
All right. And then you completed your PhD from there, is it?
Yeah. 2016, I completed my PhD in University of Southern California. Yeah.
All right. And right now you're in US, right? You're working as a professor there in Wichita University. Can you just share some things about Wichita University? Like maybe for the viewers, it would be something new.
Yeah. So I'm a professor in Wichita State University. So it's a state university. It's a public university. So it's funded by public money. And we are in the middle of the US, so this is Kansas, and we are in the middle, actually. So it's literally, like, if you think of America like this, we're right in the bang in the middle, right? So it's a city called Wichita. It's the university is, we offer several undergraduate degrees, several master's degrees, and several PhD degrees. There's a lot of international student population, especially in the engineering field. So we get a lot of students who are interested in master's in computer science, master's in industrial, mechanical, electrical, and go on to do PhDs. I'm really happy to, if anybody is interested in, you know, applying to Wichita State, I'm really happy to, you know, if you send me an email, I can, like, you know, guide you through the process and talk you about what is required and all that. Because I remember when I was applying, one of the intimidating things was the application process itself, because it's so different from anything, you know, that we have done in India, right? And I remember, like, guidance was one of the things that, you know, is really important at that point. So I'm very happy if somebody wants to apply to Wichita State to answer questions on that, because that's something that, you know, would be very useful to people, I think, to have that kind of structure and that guidance. So I teach classes in linguistics. So I do a variety of classes in linguistics. I'm also the director of the linguistics program. So I oversee all the linguistics students. So I do a lot of mentoring outside of my teaching and research as well, which is where I love to talk, as you can see. So you also saw in my profile that I'm also interested in music and I'm interested in food, right?
That's right.
I incorporate food and music into my professional career. So my research is on language and music. Work language and music with respect to, you know, how to process the two things in the brain, like how cognition works with language and processing music. So that's how I'm really interested in, you know, bringing my other passions and my other interests into my professional life. And with food, I teach a class called The Language of Food. So it's a really popular undergraduate class. It's a general education class. So we talk about the history of food. We talk about how maybe biryani is, you know, something that came from outside of India. We really love biryani in India. We're proud of our biryani. But if you look at the history of biryani, it's actually from the Mughal and the Persian and, you know, the Afghanistan, that kind of route. So maybe things that we think are close to our heart and close to home may actually be from somewhere else, right?
That's right.
Like the word Faranian is actually from the Portuguese word Faranian. So that maybe the Portuguese had something to do with bringing the red onion to India or something like that, you know. So it's a very interesting class. We eat a lot of food. We talk about food. We cook food. So I try to integrate my hobbies and passions into my teaching. So I love what I do at Wichita State. It's been 4 years. I cannot believe it's been 4 years since I finished my PhD, but it's been a good 4 years. Yeah.
That's really great. And I would say, Maitri, it's the new information. I don't know about the viewers. For me, like, there's a language for food as well. Because when I went through your profile saying that food enthusiast, I thought you might be someone who likes cooking, or you like to, you know, explore or experiment different kinds of food. But it is something new which I felt, okay, now food also has some languages.
I also cook and I also love baking. But
That's great.
So I'm trying to incorporate that love into my professional career. That's what I'm trying to say, because there's only so much time that I get to cook and bake being a professor. So by you know, dealing with it in my classroom, I also get to cook and bake and, you know, bring food to my class and share it with them and that kind of thing. Yeah.
That's beautiful. Just one more thing I wanted to, I had a doubt, and I'm sure that most of us have a wrong assumption about the word linguist. And I remember when I was speaking to you, you said, I definitely want to tell people that linguist is something different from what generally people think about. So can you just, explain us on that, what linguist is, or is there a different way of thinking what, how linguist could
be? So even for me, right, when I encountered linguistics in, say, 2004, when I was doing my master's in Hyderabad, I didn't understand what linguistics was until I actually sat in the classroom, because I had an idea of what linguistics is, and all my students have an idea of what linguistics is, and then they take a class with me and then they're like, oh my God, this is not what we thought linguistics was. The first thing that a linguist often gets is, oh, you're somebody who's interested in languages. You speak multiple languages, right? That's why you're a linguist. And I say, no, that's a polyglot. Right? Like, let's get our semantics right. A person who's interested in multiple languages is a polyglot. A person who studies language scientifically is a linguist, right? Okay. So there's a huge difference between that. So it could be a person who speaks like six languages. That's a polyglot, right? Necessarily not a linguist. But when you study language and you actively understand language from a deeper perspective. So we all use language, right? Every single day, we're using language. I am talking to you right now. I am computing all this in my brain, but I'm actually not really paying attention, or I'm not like pausing for like 5 seconds before I'm creating a sentence, right? How do we do this? I mean, the fascinating bit about this is babies, as little as like 6 months old, can start talking and can start saying words and creating sentences. I have a 2 year old right now. She's talking in sentences. And it's fascinating for me as a linguist to actually see what I teach in class in person, right? Because when she starts putting these things together, I'm like, you're 2 years old, you're doing this. It's fascinating, right? I mean, I teach this all the time, but when you see it happen right in front of you, you're like, wow, like that's incredible, right? Like, how does this happen? We don't know how it happens. I mean, people have been studying linguistics for decades and we are still interested in this question, right? How do babies pick up language? How does language happen so effortlessly? It's like breathing. That's my favorite analogy when I teach, right? So you're taking in a deep breath and you're taking a deep breath out. You're doing this without actually realizing you're doing it because it's so subconscious. And that's the same thing with language, right? I mean, you are doing it and you're not realizing you're doing it. And it's the same thing with music too, in some sense, right? Which is why I'm interested in music. I mean, we listen to music all the time. It's such a daily, everyday aspect of our life, just like language. But we don't pay attention, right? Sometimes you're like, you know, you have this earworm stuck in your head and you're like, you know all these lyrics perfectly and you know everything. And then you're like wondering, where did I hear that? Like, why is this stuck in my head, right? Like, how can I remember this? It's the same aspect. It's the same kind of questions that I ask about language, that I ask about music. Why is it that these two things that we do on an everyday basis is so trivial, but it's so complicated at the same time, right? And I think understanding that requires a deeper understanding of cognition itself, like how our brain works and, you know, what we actually do up here. And, you know, we take the brain so much for granted because, you know, we're like so busy with other things that we don't really realize that this guy up here is like doing so many things, right? So that's linguistics. It's a scientific study of human language, or, you know, language in general. And take a class in linguistics, really. I mean, I encourage all of you to take a class in linguistics. It will change your life just like it changed my life. So,
So if I'm right, if I put it in a very simple one, I would say a person who speaks multiple languages is not a linguist, but a person who has got question in his mind about every single thing when they speak or some language is being used, that person could be said as, you are really interested in linguistics. Is that
true? Yes. Yeah, if you're interested in
the why question,
because the person, he could also be a grammarian, right? He or she could also be a grammarian. A grammarian is not a linguist. I mean, we are not interested in grammar per se, but we are interested more in like, how does the brain compute language and aspects of language? So, so that's really what we're interested in. So it's a scientific study.
So if a person has a why question in the languages, maybe this person could be a linguist in future.
Yes. So let me tell you an application of linguistics, right? I mean, I think when I create that connection with industry and with real life, people understand it a lot better. So we use a lot of assistants in our life, right? Technical assistants. So Siri, Alexa, Apple, Google Home, you know, all these kind of devices are actually, you use voice recognition, right? For a lot of these. So you're talking to Alexa, you're saying, hey, Alexa, hey, Siri, hey, Google, and they respond back to you. That connection is linguistics, right?
Okay.
Because the device has to understand language, right? The device has to understand that, okay, hey, this is English, right? So I have to respond back in English, right? Or this is a subject, this is a verb, this is an object. That's the sentence structure, right? There's a lot of underlying structure associated with language that the machine has to understand, right? And it's the same thing with us, right? When we are communicating, you are understanding me because you have the same understanding of language that I have, right? So with linguistics, there's a lot of application in like the computer science linguistics kind of connection with respect to natural language processing. So with a lot of my juniors and a lot of my classmates actually got jobs in like Google in Hyderabad, where they would work on like ad words and things like that, or dictionaries, right? So like, you know, understanding dictionaries in like the phones and all that, or like Siri, right, with the voice to text transcription or voice recognition kind of thing. So there's a lot of application for linguistics in the industry as well. So it is by no means that going the academic route is the only option for a lot of people. In fact, a lot of people actually decide to go the industry route because the pay is much better. So very lucrative to do that.
So is that if someone takes a profession as a linguist, doesn't get paid much as an industry?
Yeah. So if you are a linguist with a PhD and you get a job in like Google or Facebook or something, your salary is skyrocketing high. Yeah, it's a very, very lucrative profession to be in. Also, one of the reasons why a lot of students come to me and be like, I really want to get into Google. I really want to get into Facebook. Can you help me? Kind of thing. They're not interested in being a professor. They are more interested in, you know, going into that industry route. Yeah.
And I'm just wondering who's telling that I don't want to be a professor, because I remember you telling me, I never ever thought I'd be a professor, especially in linguistics.
Yes.
If you ask me like many years back, you would never expect me to give you an answer that I would be a professor.
Because again, it's so unexpected, right? I mean, I started with PhD in chemistry and then I ended up in a PhD in linguistics and being a professor. So it's just life has a way of going and flowing. And I think I literally went with the flow of life rather than resist, you know, at each point. And I think that's really, you know, kind of where I am today in this position that I am. It's so unexpected, but it's so lovely because I love everything that I do and there is nothing that I would have done differently looking back. So.
Yeah, that's right. And I'm sure that your parents might be really happy and proud about you and also might be thinking that it's good that we didn't send you abroad or to US at that time, because this was the right time for you to be at the US and just explore as a professor there at Wichita University.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think in retrospect, my mother is happy that I didn't go at when I was 18 and I went much later when I was more sensible, if you ask her. Yeah.
What would be the message for you from, as a part of being a professor there in Wichita, being a linguist, what would you just recommend the people, those who are planning to go either abroad or to do their higher studies? I'm sure that at least for a few people, it was new that linguists could be a profession as well. Because for me, it was something new, I felt, because when I heard about your story, something which struck me was that, oh my God, a linguist, a professor. So that was something else. What would be the message for the people out there from your side?
So this is the message that I often tell my students, right? So it's the same message. It's very easy for us to get kind of stick on in our comfort zones, right? And I see that with my students quite often, right? They want to stick in Wichita because they're happy here. They grew up here. They have a family. They have a support system, right? Things are familiar. They have their favorite restaurant. They have their favorite grocery store. I often tell them, get out of your comfort zones, right? Challenge yourself, because it's so difficult to go the route that challenges you, because it's so unknown and it's so, people are very apprehensive about following the unknown because you don't know whether you'll succeed or whether you'll fail. But I often tell them that growth happens only when you challenge yourself, right? Mm-hmm. And everybody has the potential to be the best, right? Everybody. It's in every single person. You just have to find that potential. And finding that potential may come with risks that you have to take, right? Like challenging yourself, getting out of your comfort zone, going away from your family, moving to a new city. I often tell them to do a study abroad program if they can afford it. So like, you know, they, many of them go to like South America or Korea or Europe for a study abroad program, because once they go out of their comfort zone and they meet new people, they meet a different race, they meet a different culture, they meet people who speak different languages, then their world opens up, right? Then they realize that there is so many things to do. There is, you know, life is just so much bigger than what they initially thought, right? And that actually opens up their mind. It makes them a bigger, better person. It makes them kinder. It makes them, you know, do things that they might not have imagined doing before. It opens their minds to new degree programs. It makes their mind open to new careers and that kind of thing. So it's really, my message is this, that don't get stuck in your comfort zone. Go where life takes you, right? Even if you think that is, you know, it's really difficult for you to go down that path, because maybe that's something that is really scary to you or challenging to you, or you don't know what's going to happen. Let's see what happens, right? I mean, whatever happens, happens for the best. And so if you have the positive attitude, if you have the positive outlook, you will get to your potential, right? And never, never settle for second best. That's my other message, right? Be the best, and you have the potential in you to be the best. You just have to find it.
Thank you so much, Maitri, for the beautiful message. I'm sure that it would have definitely made people to rethink that, wow. Now, a girl from Cochin who wanted to go to US but couldn't go there, and finally, unexpected things happened and she ended up US. So I'm sure that it would definitely, you know, make people think about it really well, that yes, things can be possible if it has to happen, or people might start thinking that we should believe in destiny as well.
Yes, absolutely.
Maitri, thank you so much for being a part of Beautiful Minds. It was, I didn't know you, but your story strikes me some or the other way, and I thought I should definitely bring you to my show. And I'm really happy that today you have joined me. So thank you so much for being a part of Beautiful Minds.
Thank you so much for inviting me, and it was a pleasure talking to you, Kirti.
Thank you so much, Maitri. So people out there, thank you so much for joining Beautiful Minds in our 7th episode. Keep supporting Beautiful Minds. Until and unless we meet up next weekend with another interesting guest in my show, it's a bye from both of us. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.